shine like a song sad man. We get to the rhythm and we all have fun. Shubadi badum bum ba. Shubadi badum bum ba. Shubadi badum bum ba. Shubadi badum bum ba. Gotta keep moving so we all stay young and young. Most all that life is fun.
Hey guys, so this video is about my next project. I have two big ones that are going to be starting shortly. Both of them start in the new year, in January. this is the first one I'm going to start. It will be a dedication build, buddy build, that Jonas Coleman, War War Never Changes, and myself are going to be doing in dedication of Kurt Knispel, who was a German tank commander during the Second World War. He's the highest scoring tank ace of all time in history. He's not the most successful because he was killed right at the end of the war in April 1945. Now, the reason why why I wanted to do a dedication to Kurt is because this is the 70th anniversary of his death this year. And it's and he is also kind of an interesting fellow. He wasn't your, you know, typical card toting Nazi or anything like that. He was just a regular member of the German army. He was an NCO. He's from Czechoslovakia. He was basically just an auto part. He worked in an auto factory and joined the German army and worked his way up through the NCO ranks, and trained on a bunch of different vehicles until he finally ended up at the end of the war in a King Tiger and in command of it. He never progressed beyond the NCO rank. There's probably all kinds of reasons for that. He tended to be a little bit disobedient, to say the least. he wasn't very good at following the rules. He wasn't very disciplined, as you can tell by his appearance. He's a scruffy-looking nerf herder, as they say. he had a goatee, he had long hair. He kind of a bit of a rebel. He was given certain allowances by his higher-ups, certain higher-ups, not all of them, because of his incredible skill behind the gun of a German tank. The man could fire on the move and fire at the halt, and he was a deadly shot. And that afforded him a lot of allowance. So, I mean, there's even a story of him attacking a senior officer because the senior officer was horribly abusing some Russian POWs, and he assaulted him quite harshly, which would have probably got you put against the wall, I think, in many cases, or at the very least thrown in prison. I think he might have just gotten defaulters or maybe even just a small fine. I couldn't find anything what happened to him. But either way, he would have been punished, but it was light because he was allowed to continue on. There's many stories of him giving away his food, giving away his warm clothing, giving away his credits. Anytime there was a fellow tanker who claimed credit for a victory, Kurt would demur. He would step aside and say, yeah, that's yours, even though it was very easy to tell it was actually Kurt's. He would just default to, no, that's not mine. It's just the kind of guy that he was. He's quite the admirable fella in that regard. And he was just, I don't know this for sure, I'm surmising this, I'm assuming this, just fighting for his country in the best way he thought that he could. Politics aside, even though he's Czechoslovakian. still, he... Well, actually, he was born in the Sudetenland. He's not born in Czechoslovakia. Actually, I think I don't know where the two of them are related. But either way, he died in Czechoslovakia. So, either way. I'm actually just reading it right there. Probably because the two of them are written right there, and I've looked at this 10,000 times. I confuse the two. But either way. So I mentioned to Jonas that I wanted to do a dedication build to Kurt, and he is also an admirer of Kurt, so the two of us decided we're going to team up and do a buddy build. I don't know what Jonas is going to build yet. He hasn't told me. Kind of really interested to find out. I'm sure it's going to be awesome. He's already done a piece for Kurt. He did his Kursk Tiger, which was a really, really awesome piece. I thought it was pretty fantastic. Actually, this is it here. And if you'll agree, it's a really nice piece. He did a fine job on that. Paint job alone is spectacular on that tank. It's really good. And I've always wanted to build Kurt's, one of Kurt's King Tigers. He had two. He was never in command of one until the very end of the war. He was always the gunner. And he was always the gunner in one or two under one or two different fellas. So, and he was good friends with these guys. So, Rudel is it was his best friend, from what I gather. He had a couple of really close friends, but Rudel is the one who appeared more prominent. And I believe he took the last photograph of Kurt and even buried him in the end. So, you know, that says a lot right there. So, you know, it's something that someone should write a good book, just like, you know, like a dramatic representation of Kurt. He's got that kind of story that people would find intriguing, I think. No one hasn't been done in English, but I just actually gave one to a friend of mine, a German language one that I can't find it in English. I wish I could, but I gave one to a friend of mine, and I'm hoping he's going to read it and then give me a summary of what's in it. So. Either way, so this pile here is the research that I've been using, both on Kurt's tank, the one that I'm going to be building, and on him and on himself. The tank that I'm going to be building is his Normandy Tiger. It had the early production, erroneously called Porsche turret. A lot of people call it the Henschel turret and the Porsche turret. They were both done by Krupp. So it's kind of a bit of a... It's not exactly accurate, but... either way, what we normally call the Porsche turret has the a totally different front end of the bow of the turret. Has a different mantlet, and it has a bulge on the side of the turret where the cupola is. It's also smaller. Inside and holds less ammunition. The Henschel turret is bigger and has no shot trap in the front. The whole front end has been redesigned and holds more ammunition. And the bulge on the side was deleted to a much more easy to manufacture. And it was also heavier too, which had its own problems. So, but I always wanted to build Porsche. I've built two King Tigers and both of them were Henschels. And I wanted to build a Porsche. I always wanted to build a Porsche, and I always wanted it to be Kurt. Now, in this build, the reason why I have this rather large pile of research is because I'm doing a full meal deal on it with interior package and everything. So I got an extensive photo etch set and interior package from Verlinden and stuff like that. So I need as much information as I can. So I got, this is the Wikipedia, which... You know, anything you get from Wikipedia, you should always make sure you cross-check, because Wikipedia is not always the truth. It's people's opinions. It hasn't always been corroborated. So anything you get from Wikipedia, you have to make sure you go and check it again from a paper source, which that's what these things are called. These things are paper sources. These are books. Right, which is where the information from Wikipedia comes from. So a lot of people tend to squeeze their opinions into the crap that's on Wikipedia, so you got to be careful of that. Wikipedia is a good place to start looking, and then you go from there, and you leave the internet and go to the books, right? The internet is just good for quick access to get you going, point you in the right directions to what books you need to look at. When you're doing research on this stuff, don't use the internet for everything, because you're just going to get lost. There are so many armchair amateur historians that think they know everything about everything, and most of it is just conjecture or opinions, right? And myself included. I don't offer stuff like that. I won't. I'll have my opinions, and I try to keep them to myself. And I use the books. I trust the books, right? And I have multiple books on the same subject so that I can cross-reference them to see which one seems more accurate, because a lot of them are based on opinions of evidence. So you have to decide for yourself which one you think is more correct. And then it's not open to argument after that, because it's an opinion. That's how that works, right? Generally. So anyway, so that's the Wikipedia. This is the basically a pile of kit reviews on the kit that I've chosen to use, which is, to me, is King Tiger with the Porch Turret. The reason why I chose that is because the interior package that I have fits that kit. It's not necessarily the best kit. It's just the one that I happen to have the interior set, and there wasn't a good interior set for a dragon kit. So I had to go with the Tamiya. It makes no difference. The Tamiya makes a really good base, and I can just hack off all the inaccuracies anyway, so, which is what I plan to do. So, but this is the kit reviews. And I always make sure I have a good printout of them. Now, if you can get any kit reviews from Missing Links or anything like that, or Armorama and stuff like that, Cookie Sewell and David Bryden and a bunch of the other guys on there, they're absolutely excellent reviewers of kits, and they're incredible historians. So, you know, it's cool to trust what those guys say about the kits, but you should always look at them yourself. If you're going to buy the kit, see what they have to say, and then look what other reviewers have to say, and then also, again, cross-check. Make sure that the opinions are the same. If they have different opinions, then there might be something funny going on. Okay, so, the research. This is a recent acquisition that I got from Poland, from Kagero Books. It is absolute eye candy. This thing is phenomenal. I got this on the word of Paul Bretland. He told me about it. And, oh man, it is stinky with awesome, I can tell you that. It's full of colors, nice, nice color representations of camel patterns, and they're very clearly labeled as to where these vehicles served and what they're related to, which helps you go and find more information on them. Then there are all kinds of really nice photographs, right, of standing vehicles that are still in existence, both types of croup turrets, both the Porsche and the Henschel. And I don't know how accurate that is. I think that might have been a museum restoration job that they put the colors on there so you can see what the parts are. I'm pretty sure that the German army didn't color their engines like that. So if you're going to use this as a reference for the engine, I'd cross-check to make sure it didn't look like that. It looks like someone spilled their Fruit Loops on it. So, but the pictures are absolutely wonderful. They're incredibly clean and clear. But again, these are museum pieces, so you always have to make sure you check your black and white references to make sure that the museum pieces are correct, because historians and the museum staff have to make do with parts that don't exist anymore. So sometimes they have to craft their own or swap parts out from another vehicle, and that makes the vehicle inaccurate. So, I mean, they're dealing with history, so it's difficult when parts of the history are actually missing. So they do the best that they can. Like this tow cable is a replacement, right? You can tell because it's brand new, right? Then the reason why that would be a problem is you have to check to make sure that the braid is correct. So you would have to go to several black and white sources and check to make sure that the braiding is correct, if you want to go to that level of accuracy, if that's important to you. And to some of us it is. Some of us find that really important. These are 1/35th scale representations of both the of the group turrets, both inside and out, which is what I really wanted this book for. And I thought that was really, really handy. Now, I have other books that do the same thing on almost all the German vehicles. But, so either way, this is an absolutely top book. It wasn't that expensive, and I got it rather quickly, so highly recommended. This is also a recent acquisition of mine. My wife gave it to me for my birthday just recently. And it is an absolute, it's been out for a little while. It's still in print. You can get it from Amazon. It's not that expensive. It's like 25, 30 bucks. It's top notch. It really is. It's absolutely jam-packed full of pictures that I've actually never seen before on the internet or in any other book. And this thing is a treasure trove of goodies. It's got Tiger and King Tiger in here. And the reason why I'm using it as reference is because it has images of some of the King Tigers in Normandy, and that's what I was looking for. But I'm also using it for reference for one of the other build that I'll be doing for this month. So it will be spending quite a bit of time on my bench. And it's already been gone through several times. So I actually have this book too, the Febblewobble. It's the owner's manual, operator's manual for the Tiger tank. It's actually extremely cool. It's got all these goofy pictures in it. And it's got pictures of naked girls and everything to inspire the troops. It's pretty cool. Lee Larholt gave it to me. It's an incredibly generous gift. I've actually wanted that for a while, but I just never gotten around to getting it. And Lee just sent it to me at a, just for no reason. I just thought it was a really cool thing. Panzer Aces 2 I have because there's a chapter in here dedicated to Kurt. So, and I have, this is the section here. I think this is, can't remember where I had read up to. I've read this already before, but I think I'm just rereading it to refresh myself. I don't think I got up to where he made it to. No, he's still in Eastern Europe, near Kursk. He just got transferred to the dentist's tank battalion. Dr. Bake, who I built his tank to. He's cool. Actually, if you get a chance to read up on Dr. Bake, Franz Bake, he's a really cool tank commander. Actually, a squadron company commander. He ended up being a colonel. He's a pretty cool character, too. And, of course, I'm not referring to this a whole lot because it's mostly from the Allied viewpoint. But it tells me about what engagements they were involved in, and I was looking for just mostly for photographs and stuff like that. This is an exceptional book if you guys can get your hands on it. So I was just scanning through that. This is the same thing with this. This here had some interesting pictures about, so it had a couple of pictures in here about King Tigers and stuff like that. But it's in the Battle of the Bulge, which is a little later. So I scanned through it just looking for a couple of photos of the King Tigers. My main resources were the Panzer Aces 2, the Kagero King Tiger book, and these two here. But this is an exceptional book because it has King Tigers in it that were actually in service in Normandy. As you can see there, several of them. And they're really good photographic references. Unfortunately, by the time anyone took pictures of most of them, they were already blown to hell. They were like wicked bad smashed up. So they were hit by like typhoon rockets, so there wasn't a whole lot left of the things by the time they were done. I thought this was impressive. This is an impressive shot right here. You can see it's two pictures here. That's a penetration through the mantlet, well, the front plate of the turret. Right there. You can see it better there. That's a crapless 200 millimeters thick, right? Whatever the hell penetrated that, that thing had some serious oomph, right? It didn't go all the way through. I can see the second layer behind it from the sidewall of the, but there's a small penetration. That would have made, yeah, a big mess. And the really interesting bit is, I don't know if it's, it looks like the muzzle brake had been hit. Either that or this foliage that's wrapped around there, but it looks like it's been shattered. right? It's kind of weird looking. There's a really nasty strike right on the glazes. Pretty cool. But that's the stuff that I was looking for, was, you know, really good shots of the tiger in many different conditions, with foliage wrapped on it for camouflage, and battle damage, and in different positions. Mostly I wanted to see how the tracks floated on different terrain. That's a lot of what I was looking for. But this is my Bible. Anytime I want to build a tiger or a king tiger, this is the most referred to book that I have. It's basically the Modeler's Guide to the Tiger thing. And it does have a whole section in here about the king tiger. And it's extensive, to say the least. It's the most valuable book that I have in my collection, right? Not because it's worth so much. It is worth a lot of money. But it's also the most useful book I own. Because I'm a tiger nut, as Seb so eloquently referred to me as. Thanks, Seb. Because I'm a tiger nut, I have to have this book, right? And it didn't cost me much because I bought it years ago. But now I think this thing goes for anywhere from $150 to $200 American on Amazon or on eBay. So, and that's if you can find it. I really wish they would put this thing back into print. It's such a useful book. It really is. If you're going to be building a lot of tigers and you're going to be studying a lot about the tiger, this is the book you need to have. If you can get a PDF copy or find someone who knows who has the energy and the time in their life to scan it or something like that, you know, make a donation to the publisher and then get them to scan it or something like that. Because I can't even begin to say how useful this book is. Then there's this. This is also an incredibly useful book. It's basically the production history and all the modifications that were made throughout the production series of the King Tiger, right from the conception to its eventual conclusion of its series. But it has the most useful thing in here. It has the series of modifications listed by date. Every month it has all the modifications that were made to the production line. So if you know the general time that the tank that you're trying to model was produced, you can look in here and see what features have been deleted or added up to that date. So these books are really handy. There's a whole series of these. I have a lot of them. And they're wicked useful, right? And mostly for that. It helps you make your vehicle much more accurate, and you don't get the rivet counters beating the crap out of you. And then there's this. This is the other. I have both of these. There's two of them in the series. This one covers the later vehicles. And this is the section on the 503rd, which is Kurt's battalion. Mostly I got it because I'm using it because of the photographs that are in it. But it also has some interesting information about what vehicles were in service, how many vehicles were in service, and that will help me I was trying to figure out what turret number Kurt had on the Tiger that he was the gunner of. And because Kurt was not an officer, he wasn't a noble, and he was kind of disregarded by most of his higher up rankers, he didn't get well documented. So there's a lot of vagaries when it comes to his service history. So what vehicle he was in and when, there's questions, right? There's no 100% evidence about what he was in and when because, well, we haven't found it, right? So there's a lot of guys that say they know, but there's no real paperwork that I've seen or heard of that says definitively which one it is. We can assume. And we know enough about how vehicle numbering worked back then that we can come pretty close. So Now, in the research that I've done and some help that I got from Jonas and the help that I got from Ebby, another Swedish modeler, both exceptionally talented fellows. I can never remember Ebby's name on Facebook. It's like Laurent, I can't remember. He's a fantastic fella. We just call him Ebby. I don't know why he's called Ebby, but that's what we call him. But he's really, really knowledgeable about a great many subjects, and he's an incredible scratch builder when it comes to certain things. So, and he pointed me in the right direction. I had already pretty much had the information, but he helped me corroborate it. So I'm going to go with Tiger 101 for the Normandy Tiger. It'll be the turret numbers. It's the colors that I was trying to find. Each company used different colors. Some used blue and white, some used red and white, some used yellow and white, some used black and white. It all depends on the company and the division and the company commanders. So, and the style of numbering. Most companies use the same style through long stretches of the war, and then some of them changed it, some of them changed it per company, so it's difficult to find that kind of information. That's actually what I was looking for. I pretty much guessed he was in 101, but it's the stylized numbering that I'm really trying to find. I have a good idea because of what the other vehicles in the battalion were numbered like, and I have a pretty good guesstimation as to what color it'll probably be. So, but I want to confirm it before I go into it further. So, anyway, this is the kit. It's to me is what's the number? 169. It's an old kit. It's been around for quite some time. It's still useful as a base. And there's nothing really fancy about it. It needs work. You can just build it out of the box. But you're going to have the mosquito netting for the grills and plastic tool brackets and stuff like that, and molded on tow cables and everything. It's kind of ugly, right? I mean, it'll look okay. The thing is, you can always make a crappy model look good with a good paint job, right? That's the thing. You can always do a lot with a paint job, right? Panzerman Bill says this a lot, and I agree with him 1,000%. A good paint job hides a lot of flaws. Not in your work, but in kits. You can really do a lot of good with a good paint job. So if you're not a skilled builder, you can become a skilled painter, and a skilled painter forgives a lot of sins. And I'm a half-decent builder. I can build well. Painting, not as good as some others. I know some guys out there that they're asking me for hints and tips on how to paint, and these guys are so much better at painting than I am. And they do such amazing work. I'm just sitting there looking at it going, yeah, you're asking me for advice, but that's better than anything I can do. So, yeah, it's a... That's the thing. I want to improve my painting skills, but in order for me to do that, I'd have to like painting more. So. I don't like painting. Okay, so that's the kit, and this, and that are the upgrades. I'm not going to use all of this, though. I can't. I couldn't possibly. Some of them are duplicates that I accidentally got. That's the decals. I didn't actually get new decals for it because I didn't need them. I have so many decals in my stash. The decals that came with the kit, I wouldn't even consider using. They're to me anyway, so I just throw them in the garbage. I never use to me decals. They're crap. So when I first got the kit, I realized right away it needed new grills. So I got a grill set from Griffin. And then I got... For some reason, I thought I needed a fender set. Even though there's one in this, I got another one. And then another one, because apparently I was smoking a lot of pot then. I don't know. I haven't smoked pot in years. So. But yeah, so I got that too. It was another fender set. So there may be, depending on the type If you look, I don't know if you can see or not. Oh, there we go. That fender is different than that fender. So, depending on my research, it'll determine which fender style I use. So it's good to have, in this case anyway, that I have different ones because I don't know which one I'll be using. And of course, the kit comes with Crapo, to me, ancient vinyl rubber tracks, which I just threw in the garbage. So I replaced them with Vrumodel, which are beautiful. And then I long ago got the Lion Roar upgrade set, which also comes with fenders and grills, because apparently I'm insane. But it also comes with the tool brackets, and it comes with the MG mount for the turret ring and stuff like that. And that's why I got it. So I'm kind of excited about playing with this. I've used Lion Roar Photo Etch before. It's beautiful stuff. So I'm really excited about that. And then a friend of mine knew I had a King Tiger in my stash, and he sent me a replacement barrel. I already have one, and I don't know which one I'm going to use. It depends. See, this here is for the Porsche turret, and this is for the Henschel turret. Now, I don't have a Henschel turret Tiger in my stash, so I will soon. I'll get one and use this. This is the Verlinden upgrade set for the interior. It's going to be a lot of work because most of this is a lot of cleanup, and it's resin, so it's a lot of shaving and cleaning and mess and toxins and stuff like that. So it's definitely going to take me the entire 4 months, I think, to build this monster, and I plan on taking my time at it. So that's just that. So I'll be at that for some time. Now my plans for this build is to do a series of videos showing progress combined with the odd how-to on what I'm working on throughout the series. So, it'll be, I'm hoping, something a bit more useful than just the show and tells I've been doing lately. The other build that I'm planning, I'm going to do a video for in just a few minutes. So, I guess you guys will have to watch that when you see it. So, it's not quite as extensive as this, but it's a multi-piecer. I'm still trying to figure out what I'm going to do with figures on it yet. Right. So that's all I have for that. Wish me luck, I guess. And I guess I'll see you in the next video for this. You guys be good. Talk to you soon.